Yep, sorry about the bandwidth. I talked to my internet provider yesterday and they are upgrading my plan on Thursday. It's just a little bit frustrating. Just out of my control. Could be my home router, but I mean, it's right next to my desk. Oh, geez, this is getting okay, I'm not going to worry about lending. It's going to keep nagging me, unfortunately. All right, our settings are there. Now we're going to create a new app. Installed apps. And I'm just reading recently that it's better to not just include your app, but in the book recommends this to do. Instance. So this is already created under, for example, payment apps as part of an app config and gives you more flexibility with configuring it. Dude, why is this looping? I keep doing it. I just introduced pipenv, but I think it's the problem. Oh man, it's trying to install it globally. That's the deal. So here I'm inside my environment and this linter is installed. Both of these linters are installed there. Maybe I just need to install those pylint globally to make it easier. The problem is see if this works. So pilot needs also to be installed inside of this environment, and even though this pip file has black and pilot now as dev dependencies, I hope. Nope, it's good. To base. So yeah, we've got our app config instance. This is nuts. So it was looking for the wrong in the wrong virtual environment. There we go. Thank you. All right, we're set up. We've got our payment app created. We probably don't need all these files right off the bat. We'll find out which ones are required. So we will be making a view. Okay, so I gotta go to the orders and edit the views, pie. And in the order create, we are rendering this order created. Instead, we need to set the order in session. So we can keep track of it. And that's going to come from order I. From the order. Payment. And we're going to define this view, get the reverse URL for that view, and redirect the user there, keeping tabs of this order. In our implementation, we're creating the order before payment so that we can actually track the status of the order. I think that's something I'll have to add in a future session. We want to know when people have initiated the payment process, but maybe have failed for some reason. We can follow up in those cases. I'm just going to leave this code for a moment. It's a bad habit, but I'm not doing it frequently, so it's not really a habit right now. Okay. I'm not, the book's also using Celery. I'm not doing that at this point. I think it's just kind of too much, too many moving parts. Although it might be a good thing to have since this is an asynchronous process. So we're gonna edit. So basically, Braintree is going to give us an identifier for the order so that we can link it to the payment. this initial payment module. Migration, since we added a new database field. And we will commit that. And I've got to get my imports in line there. So Django shortcuts, import render, redirect and render. We'll stage that. So now we're going to payment views. Looks like we're done here for a moment. I'm done with base buy, so. A few shortcuts from Django. The next order of imports is, I'm not sure if that should go above the Django specific imports. And we need our order model. Good. So we're gonna handle the payment. ID from the session. So we can can't find an order with matching, it's gonna ID is gonna throw a 404. Payment nonce defaulting to none. Just gonna try to create that transaction with Braintree. Let's call it sale in Braintree parlance, and that's basically where it's a bookstore, so we're creating a sale. Wondering if this formatting is necessary, if it'll already be truncated, or no, it could be 3.2 or 32.2, so I think this is making sure there's two decimals, maybe, I don't know. This to be settled right away. All right. I'm going to make sure the result is okay. Cross-reference it. What the heck? And save the order with that metadata. Now we're going to redirect the payment successful screen, more or less. But sold. I like to have two L's in that. I think that's American English, is it? That's actually the British. Interesting. I pretty much speak American English, although my English is just kind of deteriorating since I've been living abroad. But I would default to like the American rules, I thought, and American spellings. Anyway, this is the American spelling, and I was defaulting to this, which is, I guess, the British spelling. Anyway, English is a messy language. Enough said. All right. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. If elf, let's see, where are we going? Else return. Okay, so what are we at? An if up here. We're gonna go down here and give it an else. And the request is not a post. Text subobject order. Okay, looking good. So basically, if the request is post, meaning like the client is attempting the transaction, we're going to grab the nonce. I don't really quite understand what a nonce is. It's just like an encrypted blob of all the payment details, I suppose. Something like that. And then we're going to send it over to, well, maybe not. The payment amount is already here, so it doesn't have to have the details. It's just a unique thing that I can't, that can't be guessed or created randomly by some hacker. Nonce. Nonce. Let me look that up real quick. I've heard it floating around. Nonce, not the slang nonce, but cryptographic nonce. Arbitrary number used only once in a cryptographic communication in the spirit of a nonce word. Random pseudo-random numbers. All right, so it's a pseudo-random number, so it can't be guessed or generated randomly with any remote likelihood, and guarantees that this transaction is authentic. We're generating from the, on the server side, from the Braintree library. So all the heavy lifting is done by Braintree, including creating this nice Python library for us. Good stuff. All right, now we need a couple more views. Payment process. Payment done, payment canceled. And these we'll get to style to our liking at some point. Just looks weird without the double L's. Create a new file inside payment URLs py. Now the book's saying to define the app name as payment here in the URLs, but I think that's already done in the apps. I don't know if this is a necessary redundancy here. Let me try it without it. multi cursor shortcut sheets. I can't remember. It took me longer to remember it than to just type. Now we're going to do the main URLs pi for everything. Payment templates. Take a look at the bookstore here. Card or something. Excuse me. So we're just inheriting from the base HTML template. You don't have to name the block in your closing tag, it's just helpful. Thank you. I guess the JavaScript is going to create inputs out of this or something. I've never done this part. Just a bootstrap button, or I'll go to class. Now, essentially, we want to make sure we're with the latest Braintree libraries. JS client min. Okay, it looks like it's actually, I'm not using the drop in, I'm using the hosted fields, so I need a different JavaScript. Ah, okay, that lets us do our own. Well, that's cool. Stuff. That's cool. Alright, how do we do it? JavaScript. The book's using 3.29, but essentially the library's moved on a little bit. 3.52 is the latest version. Okay, so I just wanted to grab that. I think the base let me double check here. The base template we're inheriting from also has a JavaScript section. Let me. Extra JS. So yeah, I can just define that script there in extra JS. So yeah, since I switched out of the Django template mode, I have to just manually do these, but I'd rather have the HTML element auto completion. To be honest, it's much nicer. Okay, now we'll put our extra JS there. And well, we do have a query there. So that's nice. I think it's just a payment form. There's quite a bit of JavaScript here. There's a bunch of extra stuff. Well, in any case. Okay. styles are necessary, but all right. Thank you. I think there's something wrong with the book's JavaScript, man. Damn it. My closing brackets don't match. I'm not sure what this false is for. Alright. So, well, one thing I've got to do is this. So I'm just going to grab it all. So this is all correct, but the book has this false somewhere. I gotta find the matching. I think it's in this form, add event listener, here. Takes a false. It's hard to read it though. And yeah, I should be storing this in a external script file, but just right now I want to get it done, and maybe I'll be able to do the external script in a minute. Black is a little bit annoying sometimes. We're not ESLing right now though. Let's see if this works. Now we just need a couple more templates really quick. More or less. So payment done. Let's see where we're at. Okay. Canceled. templates are there. We can run the server, but we need to take the user to the payment. So let's go ahead and see how we're going to get to the payment from the checkout. Okay, so it looks like that thing I was curious about in the payment, you do need the app name here. I think that's the deal. So let's see how they were doing that app name. Oops. Okay, cool. So it's a little bit redundant if we already defined the app name here, but that gives us the namespacing. So, payment process. Good to know. All right. Now, since we need to go to the bookstore, add to the cart, go to the checkout. Is not defined. Okay, cool. Orders create, so I've just got to hop back over there and close a couple tabs so it's not too confusing. HTML can be closed. Payment process view. Actually, the viewer in is still the order. We're hopping from the order to the payment. Order views. Django shortcuts. I think reverse should be here. Okay, pay online, and doesn't quite work. Let's check our browser console. And call for reference, dollar sign is not defined. Okay, makes sense. jQuery is not included in the front end code. All right, so just do things with regular web APIs in this case. You might not need jQuery. So we're gonna hop back over to our template payment. Process, and I just got to change the way I get these payments. Oh, let's see. They're using query selector. This should work though if I just say get element by ID. And in this case, they're using document query selector. Input type submit. Since we're using JavaScript, to kind of signal that we're in JavaScript, I use single quotes by default. And then since we're mixing quotes, you have to alternate. All right, so let's see now. Process, will that work now? Client instance is not defined. On what line? Well, let me go back to create. So error in callback function. Okay. Got a typo in my camel case. Okay, looking kind of good. I'd almost still prefer to use the drop-in form, to be honest. That's the wrong one. So they are using these bootstrap classes, the form control. That should just give us a little tighter. Aesthetics, and it'll integrate with our bootstrap material. This is interesting that in the book it doesn't use the expiration field. Oh, it does. Let me make sure I got it. Yes, right here. Good, good. So I need these feedback though. This is important. So we got a label for credit card number, the form field for credit card number, and the invalid feedback. It's in a row. I guess it doesn't need any specific CC expiration. This code in the pen. Okay, so the placeholder is there. Excellent. But the other fields are not rendering now. I just think that I was kind of expecting to do this drop-in form. Instead of the hosted fields, the drop-in UI just seems a lot simpler. And it doesn't look too bad. So we do want this. In the event listener for the button. Yes, the payload knots. Actually, I do want to space there just to make it a little more legible. And I'm going to use the restroom really quick. I'll be right back. Thank you. think we basically need a form field in here. This hidden nonce field is cool. All the request really needs is this nonce. The rest of this stuff's gonna be handled on the server, and then the CSRF token off to make sure it's secure, and an input, more or less. That's all we need. Creates authorization comes from this server, which was client token. And dropping container, I believe this is looking good. Query selector, get element ID, get this button. It says submit button, which means I need to change this. It's not a still closing tag anymore. Font awesome icon in there, or something like that. All right, I think we're good. We've still got the form method to make the post. That way the browser handles the, I don't know how to use jQuery or a JavaScript AJAX call or something like that. I don't want to do that if the browser's already going to do that for me. And we just needed this drop in to render the form fields, which is cool. I don't want to wrestle with the styling and all that. Submit is the event now. It's not going to work as it is. Until I do this. So yeah, form. Okay, I got it. So we need to reference the form. So when the form is submitted, we're going to prevent the default real quick and do the asynchronous call. So we get an event inside that function. From the payload, setting it. as the next step is to submit the form. All right, let me read this through one more time. So we don't need the submit button reference there. It's part of the form. It's going to cap. That's responsible for creating the event. So payment form. Explicit here. A lot less code, a lot less JavaScript, and I don't need all the, you know, fiddling with the styles and stuff. I just hope this is gonna work. Payment button. All right, so let's go back. All right, this is good. Create order. Here's the moment, and ooh, it works. And this button is. It's already an integer. Wait, it is an integer, it's not a float. Okay, so that's unexpected. Say that I should be using strict typing or something along those lines. I believe like TypeScript camp. I'm not totally excited about that. I do like this duck typing or dynamic typing. Let's just go take a look at this real quick. In the payment views, we've got this formatter here. I suppose I could just get the total cost. It's curious though why it's coming through as an integer instead of a float. So let's take a look at this order model. Decimal field there. I think what's happening. Okay, because my just field formatters is messed up. So it is a float there. It could be an integer or a float, but the, let me see if there's a different way of formatting these. So this is all working good. And I believe I'm just gonna delete this now. So the problem being in this view for payment, we have this view and it's trying to format this amount. I'm not even sure that that's necessary. Idea, because even in our model for product, we're storing as a decimal field. I should probably just call this and not try to mess with it at all. Strings a decimal field to avoid some kind of rounding errors to begin with. So let's hop back over here. We're not getting those errors. The payment being canceled is probably I need to leave that open next time. So let's go back to the shopping cart. Do full flow. And it clears out the cart. Ooh, that's gonna be form is not defined. Okay, callback function form. So yeah, I just gotta be more careful with my JavaScript here. Templates. This is orders and my payment templates. Process. Should be called payment form now. Payment form add event listener. There we go, and that's probably why the payment was canceled. Cool. Alrighty then. Now if I go to testing user, I log in, I just hop over to the Wagtail admin, and I get out of this mode now. We go to the store, orders, oh boy. Email somewhere is paid. first paid order, this one was the one earlier. Okay, dude, this is cool. Let's check one thing in the sandbox. Clear out these old orders. Except the paid one, I want to leave that. Now if we have, we'll go to the Braintree sandbox. I'm gonna log in real quick. Off stream, I suppose. One moment, please. In here to the Braintree sandbox mode, and it looks like we've got one sale for $18. Very cool, dude. All right, let's do this again. Yes, again, I want to give attribution during the stream because I've had some troubles with my bandwidth. I keep getting disconnected, so I'm not sure. A lot of this is coming from a really excellent book, Django 2 by Example, from Pact Publishing. In this session, I've deviated substantially using the drop-in UI, for example, because it's just less code, it's nicer. But this book has been a very good reference and guide through this process of creating the e-commerce part of the site. All the code is open source. The book is like $30 or something like that. This is not a paid endorsement. This is just attribution because the book has been so helpful along my way. And I only have minor qualms with some of the issues, mainly there's some errata in the book, but the source code tends to have things worked out. Okay, so let's go ahead and round out this session. It's been an hour and a half. I'm gonna create another order and see if I can get something funny going on with the price. So, for example, adding that. Somehow the price got messed up there, but that's cool. And we'll go back to the bookstore and add one of those. So now we're at $39.96. We'll check out. Another order. One to the main street. Oh, that's another postcode. Any town. Any state. U.S. We use the same card because there's a dummy card, I think. 0120. Okay, we're gonna try it out. Payment was successful. Payment was processed successfully. Right, so now if I hop over to Wagtail Admin, I go to the store, orders, another order, paid. Inspecting it, I see that we got these things. We hop over here to the sandbox. I refresh the page for the Braintree gateway. And now we have sales volume. No, didn't change there. Let's go to transactions, see what's going on here. Search for transactions. Well, there it is, $39.96, it showed up. Ah, there goes 58 euros dollars sales volume today. All right, I'm gonna close out this stuff, make a few commits, rounding out the session. So just gotta think for a second. Depleted. have to come back to look at whether or not I should clear the cart. The funny thing, the problem is that the cart should be cleared. I need to figure out a way to keep in this order around in the case of the failed payment order ID. That's the thing. So once we've created an order, then the car should be cleared. Okay. Well, if there's a bug, I'll have to come back and fix it. But in any case, so clean up the code. I think all we need to do is import. What did we do here? There we go. Import reverse. All right, so the main URLs we have now imported. Payment URLs. Oops. Don't do that. Yeah, so the book Django 2 by example helped with most of this code. I maybe made a few minor changes here, but yeah, this came straight up, pretty much straight out of the book. So it's really a good book. So everything is committed and it's pretty much working. There may be some bugs we'll uncover later. At this point, it's about 11 o'clock here, Eastern European time. We've made some good progress on this project, including rounding out the whole payment checkout flow. Where we have a cart, we create an order from the cart when the customer is ready, and then have integrated the Braintree payment processor. Now, in the following sessions, we'll probably just tweak this a little bit. I'm gonna get some feedback this Wednesday about the checkout process. So I don't know what the specific next steps are. I could tweak this template a little bit, the order inspection view, for example. In any case, thanks for watching. Thanks for hanging out on Twitch, and if you're checking these videos out on YouTube, the source code is on GitHub, github.com/westernfriend, if you want to see the current status of the project at any time. If you have any questions or comments, do feel free to leave them below the video and I will respond promptly. If you're interested in learning Python and Django, I welcome new contributors to this project. I will give a quick shout out to CodeBuddies.org. This is a really great learning and teaching community, peer learnings, hangout sessions on many different topics. And we're in the middle or in the beginning stage of a rewrite to Python and Django. So it's a good opportunity to get on board at the ground level of an open source project for peer learning. It's open source on GitHub. Great. Well, thanks again for watching. Hope to see you all around and have a great day.